My name is Claire Day. I'm the Chief Program Officer at the Alzheimer's Association, and it's my privilege to be able to introduce our next speaker and to also extend a warm welcome to all of you this afternoon who have joined us. We're going to switch gears a little bit this afternoon and start really focusing a little bit more on some of those advanced care planning subjects that we've alluded to earlier in our program today. And at the Alzheimer's Association, we're working really hard to ensure that there's an awareness and understanding of what some of these needs are. We've been fortunate enough to be funded by the Stupski Foundation, who is helping us to identify areas that are needed, gaps in end-of-life discussions around advanced care planning. And so we really wanted to pull some of that information together today, and we're going to kick that off with our next speaker. It's my pleasure to, oh, and I should also point out my colleague, Rachel Main, in the back. She has pulled together a lot of great information. If you all turn around, Rachel's waving, right? Wave back at her. Rachel is one of our family care specialists who works out of our San Francisco office and has been leading these end-of-life issues, grants and issues, and so we're delighted to have her here today with a lot of great information. So I encourage you to visit her at the next break. But it's now my pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Barak Gaster, who is visiting us today from Seattle. Dr. Gaster is a professor of medicine at the University of Washington. In the past, he has served as the medical director at the University of Washington General Internal Medicine Center and serves now as the chair of the University of Washington's Advanced Care Planning Committee. Dr. Gaster obtained his medical degree from the University of California, San Francisco, followed by internal medicine training at the University of Washington. Dr. Gaster is a primary care physician providing care for more than 20 years to a wide range of patients, while also developing research and curriculum on many challenging topics in medicine. Dr. Gaster's focus is now on developing training for primary care clinicians, developing a program to help them learn how to identify dementia earlier, and how patients and families navigate through the various stages of the disease. Gaining attention most recently, Dr. Gaster has developed a dementia-specific living will, which was described in the journal JAMA and received wide media coverage in both the New York Times and National Public Radio. It's our pleasure to welcome Dr. Gaster today to speak about advanced directives for dementia. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Barak Gaster.
All right. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you so much for that kind introduction, Claire. It's just such an honor to be here to share with you all the work that I've been doing, especially on advanced care planning for dementia. You know, it's a hard issue. It's a new issue that is really gaining more and more attention. You know, just as we shift a little bit from, you know, let's find a cure to how can we provide better care now for the patients living with dementia. And so, as Claire mentioned, I'm a primary care doctor. So I've been a primary care doctor for about 20 years. And during that time, I spend most of my time caring for patients as their primary care doctor. I also do a lot of education. So I train medical students and internal medicine residents. But then I've all, over the years, have had about 20 to 30% of my time focused on finding solutions to the most difficult issues that primary care doctors face. And it was about 4 years ago that it really hit me that maybe the hardest issue in primary care for us as primary care doctors to face and for our patients to face is dementia. And so it's been about 4 years now that I've been working in this area. And you know, as I got more and more into thinking about, you know, what do primary care doctors need to know about dementia, really the issue of advanced care planning and advanced directives really sort of came to the fore, and so that's what I'll talk about today. And so I don't want to spend a lot of time. You guys have all heard many people talk about, and you all came in here knowing what a big problem dementia was, but just this is a huge issue that I can tell you from the point of view of primary care is increasingly more and more people in primary care are increasingly aware of just how huge of an issue this is as an unrecognized issue in our patients in primary care clinics. You know, that, you know, especially, so primary care doctors, especially those in internal medicine, take care of a lot of people over age 85, and so many of those people have dementia. And, you know, and the reason, as you all know, that this is so important for us to actively start engaging in with now is that as big a problem as dementia is now, in the next few years, 5, 10, 15 years, as the baby boomer bubble ages, as people sort of live longer, as we do a better job of treating people for their cancer and for their heart attacks, more and more people are living into their 70s and 80s, and so more and more people are going to be at risk for dementia. So really, as big a problem as we have right now with dementia, in the next 20 years or so, this is likely going to double and triple. So really, this is the number one disease challenge that we face, that you know, as many challenges as there are in primary care, problems that I have worked on over the last 20 years, the opioid epidemic, how to treat chronic pain in a safe way, how to talk to patients about the pros and cons of prostate cancer screening, sort of herbs and supplements, other dietary supplements. Those are all hard issues in primary care, but really they all kind of sort of recede as we really grapple with just how big a deal dementia is. And that advanced care planning for dementia is right there at the core of how do we make sure that we are making the medical interventions that we give to patients align with the care that a patient would have wanted. And so some people have said, you know, well, but why do we need something special for dementia? I mean, shouldn't we be focusing on just general advanced care planning, trying not to make it dementia specific, but you know, have it somehow include dementia? And part of the reason that it is important to think about a dementia specific living will is that dementia is a really unique problem. So among the common problems that we face in primary care, the fact that this is a disease in which people gradually and slowly lose the ability to interact and understand what's going on around them, during which they live for many, many years without the ability to guide their own care, there really is not a common disease that we sort of deal with in primary care that really meets both of those criteria. And so, you know, as people have said before today, leaving families in this very uncertain predicament of are the medical decisions that they're making on behalf of their loved one what their family member would have wanted. And, you know, which is an incredible source of distress, you know, that burden of wondering, are we doing the right thing? And it's pretty amazing that when you ask people who don't have dementia, do you have a pretty clear idea of what kind of medical care you would want if you had dementia? An awful lot of people say yes. And I, especially in a huge group like this, it's always interesting to me to ask a big group. And you know, you're obviously a self-selected group, but how many people in this room have pretty clear ideas about the medical care that they would want if they were to develop dementia? You know, so, I mean, this is something that is on a lot of people's minds. People have a lot of clear ideas, but there is just not easy, there are not easy and effective ways for them to express their wishes. And so this is a study that was done at Harvard, you know, a brilliant guy in the advanced care planning committee community named Velades, who asked 200 people who were over the age 65 who did not have dementia and showed half of them a video and gave half of them a verbal narrative of people with severe dementia. And for both groups, 72% indicated that they would not want life prolonging care if they were in an advanced dementia state. They would want comfort-oriented care only. And as you all know, this is not what's happening. You know, so I think there is clearly a mismatch between the care that we are giving people with who have advanced dementia with the care that they would have wanted if we could bring them back from 15 years before and have them look down at the cells now and say, you know, is this the care that you would want for yourself? An awful lot would say no. You know, but it's also true that dementia is a really complex disease. It's not like you can say, if I have dementia, I want this. And part of that really tricky nugget is that dementia is a very slowly progressive disease that changes a lot as it goes along. So from mild to moderate to severe stages, the quality of life that people have with dementia changes a lot. And so it would make a lot of sense that people's goals of care would change along those various stages, with a real emphasis on people who have early dementia still have really, really good quality of life. And it is so important to emphasize that. So, you know, talking about how do you communicate with people when you are first making a diagnosis of dementia, when people are in that early stage of memory loss, really emphasizing you have many years of good quality of life left before you. And so there may be some who would say, I would want comfort care-oriented care at that point. But many, if they really understood the quality of care, if they really understood the quality of life that they had for many years in that early stage, would not. And so as their disease progressed, it would make sense that the goals of their care would change. And so it was a pretty eye-opening experience for me as I started to think about this, to start reading the standard advanced directives that there are in all 50 states. So every state has its official, sort of legislatively sanctioned advanced directive. And they vary somewhat from state to state, but there is a pretty amazing consistency in the fact that most officially state-sanctioned advanced directives focus so much on the high profile but very rare conditions that lawyers like to think about, which are if I were in a persistent coma, if I were in a persistent vegetative state, or if I was imminently going to die from my disease. And none of those conditions apply to dementia. And so it really is the fact that standard advanced directives do not meet the need that we were just talking about of people having clear ideas of what they would want for their care if they got dementia, but the standard advanced directive form doesn't meet that need. You know, which is really a big deal, because the number one reason that somebody is likely to need an advanced directive because they're unable to make medical decisions for themselves, the number one reason is dementia. And so the idea of developing a simple and easy to use form, which was a dementia specific living will, an advanced directive for dementia, is to give people some degree of structure before they have dementia to express their wishes, with the main idea being that this is a communication tool to facilitate conversation and discussion, but also to give them an easy way to have that down on paper as a resource to help inform decisions which families might face in the future. You know, and again, with the goal being to improve the care that we give by better aligning the care that patients get with the care that they would have wanted. And so, wrote about this in JAMA, so presented the idea of a simple dementia-specific advanced directive that I quickly realized that just writing about the idea wasn't going to be enough, and that an awful lot of people would be like, you know, where can I get this directive? And so set up a website, dementiadirective.org, where the directive is available free for download. And I can tell you that in the 4 months now since it was in JAMA and then written about in the New York Times and on National Public Radio, that directive has been downloaded 56,000 times with still about 200 downloads per day. And so there was a huge giant spike when the New York Times article came out, but I think that there is enough momentum for this idea that people are hearing about it and learning about it and sharing the information among themselves, that it is to some degree becoming a more widely recognized document that people could use. And so the way that we set up this directive is to begin by describing in very, very short, concise ways what mild, moderate, and severe dementia is like. And you know, this is hard. I mean, we all know, all of you are experts in dementia care, and you all know that every patient's journey through dementia is different. The milestones that they reach are going to happen at different rates and in different order. But to some extent, you can identify common things that happen in mild dementia and in moderate dementia and severe dementia. And so begin by having a brief description about each one of those stages. And then under each of those three descriptions, giving people four options to choose from for what they would want the goals of their care to be at that stage of dementia. And this is also, this is hard. You know, it is hard to sort of codify this in a structured way, but unless you do it in a simple and checkboxy way, it's going to be really, really difficult for people to translate their ideas and thoughts into something sort of real and concrete that they can share and have sort of documented. And so the obvious sort of ends of the spectrum are that I would want full efforts to prolong my life, including CPR, to the other end of the spectrum, which is that I would want comfort-oriented care only, focused on relief of suffering and avoidance even of antibiotics. But then trying to come up with two intermediate goals of care between those two is really important, because this is a very slowly progressive disease that changes in subtle and gradual ways, where it would make sense that somebody's goals of care might not be on either end of that spectrum as their disease progresses. And so the first intermediate step would be, I would want care to prolong my life unless my heart stopped or I needed to be hooked up to a breathing machine. So I would want full efforts to prolong my life, but I would not want CPR and I would not want mechanical ventilation. And here it's really important to talk, so you know, the palliative care community, which really helped to inform a lot of the wording of this document, really emphasizes that it's important to not focus just on the kind of checkbox of this intervention, not that intervention, but really to think about what are the goals and values that people have that lead them to make that choice. And so for no CPR and no intubation, it's really the idea that I would feel good about where my quality of life was at that stage of dementia. And so if my life could be prolonged, then I would want that care. But if something hugely dramatic and catastrophic happened, like I wasn't able to breathe for myself or my heart stopped, I would be so worried that the condition that I might be resuscitated to would be worse than the one that I started out with, that I wouldn't consider that a quality of life that I would necessarily want prolonged. The next intermediate step is, I would want care to prolong my life as long as it could be given in the place where I was living. But if, despite that care, I was getting worse and I wasn't getting better, then I wouldn't want to go to the emergency room. I wouldn't want to be hospitalized. And there, thinking about what is that goal or value, why choose that level of care, it really is all about the incredible stress and harm that can happen when people with dementia are in the emergency room or in the hospital. That somebody might say, I might want care at that stage of my dementia to prolong my life, but if it got to a point where I needed the stress and potential harm of going to an emergency room or being hospitalized, that I would not consider that care sort of worth the benefit of that care worth the harm. And so those are the four options to choose from for goals of care under each of the three state descriptions of stages of dementia. And so, you know, it's a simple, it's got a two-page preamble, and then it's a three-page, one page for each stage of dementia. So it's a five-page document that you can download for free that goes through mild, moderate, and severe dementia, and then allows you to choose from one of those four choices for each of those stages. And so since this has become gotten so much attention. A lot of people have written me about it. So, you know, my email address is on the website. My email address was in the JAMA article. A lot of people have emailed me. I've probably received 600 or so emails from people with either questions or comments. And you know, overwhelmingly, people are so grateful for this document. You know, people saying things like, my mom had Alzheimer's, she suffered for 8 years without being able to speak or understand. Having had this document would have helped our family so much. Or, I had to fly blind with my mom's dementia. I don't want the same thing to happen to my kids. I gave a copy of it to all my friends. Everyone should have it. Or, I've worked for many years with people with dementia. Your document distills the most important issues about it. It's simple and easy to use. Thank you. So then an interesting phenomenon that happened in my journey to come up with this document is, when I was first developing it, my initial thought was the best time to give a document like this to somebody would be as part of that initial diagnosis. So as me, a primary care doctor, when I'm diagnosing somebody with mild cognitive impairment, that's the moment when I am the most sure that a document like this is going to be really needed and important in their future. And so that's the time to bring this document out. And so as I was developing it, I had the very interesting experience of pulling it out at those times, and over again, people would look at me and say, yes, this is great, thank you, I will take it home and I'll read it and I'll fill it out and I'll get it to you. But over and over again, it just didn't happen. And it was a very interesting experience that really made me stop and think, sort of, why is this document so difficult for somebody to fill out when they have mild cognitive impairment? And there's two reasons that I can think of that I'm pretty sure are both at play. One is that, you know, in that early diagnosis stage, there's definitely just a state of shock, that it is difficult for people to really the fear of imagining sort of what their future sort of path is almost too much for them to really sort of engage with. But I think that there is also a point that doing advanced care planning for yourself, especially in a detailed way like this, is a pretty advanced cognitive sort of process. You know, that not only are you imagining, I mean, you start out with this pretty amazing leap of, okay, now imagine a future state of your mind. So that already is a leap. But then not only are you doing that, but you're saying, in this future state of your mind, imagine these various hypothetical scenarios and try to sort of predict what you would want in those various hypothetical scenarios of this future state of your mind. And it's just like, you know, you very quickly, I think, overwhelm somebody's ability to really engage with this level of detailed planning. And so, you know, the very interesting sort of experience I had then, after I realized that giving this to people in that early stage memory loss point wasn't working, I started giving it to people, my patients who were in their 60s or 70s, who didn't have any signs of dementia, but were certainly at risk of developing it in the future. And I would pull it out and go through it with them, and like eyes lit up and like, oh my gosh, this is so great, thank you so much. You know, yes, I will fill it out and I will mail it back to you. And you know, in my experience of my own patients, you know, probably more than 70% of people who I give this to do mail me back a filled out version. You know, so a completely different experience than trying to give it to somebody with mild cognitive impairment. You know, really speaking to just how difficult that advanced care planning process is for the newly diagnosed. And so if you were to ask me when is the best time to fill out a dementia-specific living will, it would be everybody when they turn age 65 or 70. There's certainly nothing wrong with doing it before then, but I would say that, you know, as you all know, your risk of developing dementia in your 50s and early 60s, it's not that it never happens, but it's a very, very rare condition compared to people who are in their late 60s, 70s, and 80s. And a dementia directive that was filled out 30 years before somebody developed dementia is less likely to be sort of meaningful or necessarily sort of applicable to what they would want then and there. And so I really would think of this as an important document for anybody to fill out once they reached age 65 or 70. And from a primary care provider point of view, that immediately leads to the idea of the Medicare annual wellness visit. You know, so that is the Medicare has set up the annual wellness visit for people as they sort of enter into Medicare at age 65, and this is an absolutely perfect thing for primary care doctors to be offering to patients as part of the annual wellness visit. And so, you know, I think we'll talk about this more later this afternoon, but you know, the most important thing to do with a document like this is to fill it out, to think carefully about it, to review your answers with as many close family members and friends as you can and give them copies. You know, so that is really the key. So filling it out is good, but unless you fill it out and then share it with people and talk about what your wishes are, it is not going to be nearly as effective as a tool to help guide your future care. And then so importantly is to mail a copy to your doctor, ask your doctor to review it and put a copy of it in your medical record and discuss it with her or him at your next doctor visit. You know, which immediately sort of raises the question, probably the number one reason, the number one question that I have gotten among those 600 emails that I have received is, you know, is this legal? Like, you know, can we really sort of count on this as being sort of a binding document? Is it enforceable? And from there, I would say that it is really time to delegalize advanced directives. And so at the bottom is an editorial, an essay that was written in the New England Journal last year that had the really arresting title of "Let's Delegalize Advanced Directives," which is such an important, brilliant concept that really, for me as a primary care doctor, really, really sort of speaks to, you know, what is an advanced directive for, and you know, how can we use it? What is what is its true sort of meaning and value? And because currently what happens is, because it is called a living will, it gets sort of tossed in with all of your other estate planning. So it gets tossed in with your sort of your actual will, and you pay a lawyer a lot of money to fill it out, and then it gets locked up in your security deposit box, and nobody is really sure if they filled it out. Nobody is really sure what it says. Your doctor, your care team, certainly doesn't know what it says. And so, I mean, it really, not only does it not meet the needs of dementia, the standard advanced directive, but nobody even really knows where it is or what it says. And that's the legalization of an advanced directive. And so for me, such an important concept, which this dementia-specific advanced directive really is all about, is delegalizing it. Let's not get caught up and hung up on, is this a legally binding document? Let's think about it as a communication tool. Let's think about it as a guide for healthcare proxies to pay a lawyer a lot of money to fill it out, and then it gets locked up in your security deposit box, and nobody is really sure if they filled it out. Nobody is really sure what it says. Your doctor, your care team, certainly doesn't know what it says. And so, I mean, it really, not only does it not meet the needs of dementia, the standard advanced directive, but nobody even really knows where it is or what it says. And that's the legalization of an advanced directive. And so for me, such an important concept, which this dementia-specific advanced directive really is all about, is delegalizing it. Let's not get caught up and hung up on, is this a legally binding document? Let's think about it as a communication tool. Let's think about it as a guide for healthcare proxies to pay a lawyer a lot of money to fill it out, and then it gets locked up in your security deposit box, and nobody is really sure if they filled it out. Nobody is really sure what it says. Your doctor, your care team, certainly doesn't know what it says. And so, I mean, it really, not only does it not meet the needs of dementia, the standard advanced directive, but nobody even really knows where it is or what it says. And that's the legalization of an advanced directive. And so for me, such an important concept, which this dementia-specific advanced directive really is all about, is delegalizing it. Let's not get caught up and hung up on, is this a legally binding document? Let's think about it as a communication tool. Let's think about it as a guide for healthcare proxies to pay a lawyer a lot of money to fill it out, and then it gets locked up in your security deposit box. And nobody is really sure if they filled it out. Nobody is really sure what it says. Your doctor, your care team, certainly doesn't know what it says. And so, I mean, it really, not only does it not meet the needs of dementia, the standard advanced directive, but nobody even really knows where it is or what it says. And that's the legalization of an advanced directive. And so for me, such an important concept, which this dementia-specific advanced directive really is all about, is delegalizing it. Let's not get caught up and hung up on, is this a legally binding document? Let's think about it as a communication tool. Let's think about it as a guide for healthcare proxies to pay a lawyer a lot of money to fill it out, and then it gets locked up in your security deposit box. And nobody is really sure if they filled it out. Nobody is really sure what it says. Your doctor, your care team, certainly doesn't know what it says. And so, I mean, it really, not only does it not meet the needs of dementia, the standard advanced directive, but nobody even really knows where it is or what it says. And that's the legalization of an advanced directive. And so for me, such an important concept, which this dementia-specific advanced directive really is all about, is delegalizing it. Let's not get caught up and hung up on, is this a legally binding document? Let's think about it as a communication tool. Let's think about it as a guide for healthcare proxies to pay a lawyer a lot of money to fill it out, and then it gets locked up in your security deposit box. And nobody is really sure if they filled it out. Nobody is really sure what it says. Your doctor, your care team, certainly doesn't know what it says. And so, I mean, it really, not only does it not meet the needs of dementia, the standard advanced directive, but nobody even really knows where it is or what it says. And that's the legalization of an advanced directive. And so for me, such an important concept, which this dementia-specific advanced directive really is all about, is delegalizing it. Let's not get caught up and hung up on, is this a legally binding document? Let's think about it as a communication tool. Let's think about it as a guide for healthcare proxies to pay a lawyer a lot of money to fill it out, and then it gets locked up in your security deposit box. And nobody is really sure if they filled it out. Nobody is really sure what it says. Your doctor, your care team, certainly doesn't know what it says. And so, I mean, it really, not only does it not meet the needs of dementia, the standard advanced directive, but nobody even really knows where it is or what it says. And that's the legalization of an advanced directive. And so for me, such an important concept, which this dementia-specific advanced directive really is all about, is delegalizing it. Let's not get caught up and hung up on, is this a legally binding document? Let's think about it as a communication tool. Let's think about it as a guide for healthcare proxies to pay a lawyer a lot of money to fill it out, and then it gets locked up in your security deposit box. And nobody is really sure if they filled it out. Nobody is really sure what it says. Your doctor, your care team, certainly doesn't know what it says. And so, I mean, it really, not only does it not meet the needs of dementia, the standard advanced directive, but nobody even really knows where it is or what it says. And that's the legalization of an advanced directive. And so for me, such an important concept, which this dementia-specific advanced directive really is all about, is delegalizing it. Let's not get caught up and hung up on, is this a legally binding document? Let's think about it as a communication tool. Let's think about it as a guide for healthcare proxies to pay a lawyer a lot of money to fill it out, and then it gets locked up in your security deposit box. And nobody is really sure if they filled it out. Nobody is really sure what it says. Your doctor, your care team, certainly doesn't know what it says. And it's, I mean, it really, not only does it not meet the needs of dementia, the standard advanced directive, but nobody even really knows where it is or what it says. And that's the legalization of an advanced directive. And so for me, such an important concept, which this dementia-specific advanced directive really is all about, is delegalizing it. Let's not get caught up and hung up on, is this a legally binding document? Let's think about it as a communication tool. Let's think about it as a guide for healthcare proxies to pay a lawyer a lot of money to fill it out, and then it gets locked up in your security deposit box, and nobody is really sure if they filled it out. Nobody is really sure what it says. Your doctor, your care team, certainly doesn't know what it says. And it's, I mean, it really, not only does it not meet the needs of dementia, the standard advanced directive, but nobody even really knows where it is or what it says. And that's the legalization of an advanced directive. And so for me, such an important concept, which this dementia-specific advanced directive really is all about, is delegalizing it. Let's not get caught up and hung up on, is this a legally binding document? Let's think about it as a communication tool. Let's think about it as a guide for healthcare proxies to pay a lawyer a lot of money to fill it out, and then it gets locked up in your security deposit box, and nobody is really sure if they filled it out. Nobody is really sure what it says. Your doctor, your care team, certainly doesn't know what it says. And it's, I mean, it really, not only does it not meet the needs of dementia, the standard advanced directive, but nobody even really knows where it is or what it says. And that's the legalization of an advanced directive. And so for me, such an important concept, which this dementia-specific advanced directive really is all about, is delegalizing it. Let's not get caught up and hung up on, is this a legally binding document? Let's think about it as a communication tool. Let's think about it as a guide for healthcare proxies to pay a lawyer a lot of money to fill it out, and then it gets locked up in your security deposit box, and nobody is really sure if they filled it out. Nobody is really sure what it says. Your doctor, your care team, certainly doesn't know what it says. And it's, I mean, it really, not only does it not meet the needs of dementia, the standard advanced directive, but nobody even really knows where it is or what it says. And that's the legalization of an advanced directive. And so for me, such an important concept, which this dementia-specific advanced directive really is all about, is delegalizing oriented care only at a severe stage of dementia. Let's make it easy and clear and not controversial for them to fill this form out. And so the assistance with manual eating and drinking is not on this form. I do often recommend either the state of New York form or the state of Washington form. Neither of which are sort of legally sanctioned. Neither of them are legislatively sanctioned, unlike the standard advanced directive that every state has. And they will certainly lead to legal challenge down the road that we'll all be interested to follow. So I would encourage somebody who has strong ideas about it to fill a form like that out. But we left it off of our form for that reason. So what are the benefits of filling out a dementia directive? What I have seen sort of personally over and over again among my own patients who have filled this out is a huge peace of mind. People are worried about dementia, especially people who, like all of you, have very direct experience caring for people with dementia, worry about it, and have very clear ideas of what medical care we would want. And so having a form like this to fill out really does give one peace of mind that it is more likely that the care that one would get if they developed dementia would align with the care that they would have wanted. There's also potential for peace of mind for families who are filling, who are caring for somebody who has filled out a directive like this, to have some of that burden relieved, have some of the sort of stress of knowing that the decisions that they're making on behalf of their loved ones is really guided by what their loved one would have wanted. You know, in the advanced care planning discussions that I have with families for patients who have moderate stage or severe dementia, you know, so much of the conversation is really about, you know, let's do the thought experiment. If we could bring your loved one from 15 years ago back and they were looking down on themselves today, you know, what would they say they would want us to do? You know, which is, you know, that's a really good framework to help people think about it, but it is challenging and hard. And if we could pull out a directive that somebody had filled out 10 years ago, in which it was, you know, really clear that if they had moderate or severe stage dementia, that they would really want comfort-oriented care only, it is immediately so much easier to take that step and make that the goals of care for somebody. So really, it's all about better care, aligning care with what care people would have wanted. And so we have time for questions now, but we will also have time for questions with the panel. But I really want to emphasize that this is not about sort of ending people's lives with dementia earlier. This is not about, starving them. This is not about any of the bad things that can sometimes be thought of sort of life-limiting care. This is all about really wanting to put the caring back into comfort care. It's all about wanting to improve the general care that we're giving to patients with dementia. So thank you very much.
So I have two questions. I volunteer at the Zen Hospice Project in San Francisco, and every week I see people that can't talk, can't feed themselves, they're in their bed. And I guess you're really speaking to those people, or at least the future people that could be in that position around the eating, the manual feeding. I just feel so strongly about that, and I had someone who wanted to wanted to end their life through voluntary stopping of eating and drinking. But it was hard to get medical support.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so the people that were wanting to support their loved one, their hands were tied because they would be implicated.
Yeah.
And I just want to know, I know we're taking this one step at a time, and your advanced care directive is like the first courageous step, and there will be other steps, but just as I asked the question about the economic, I mean, you can't separate any of these issues that are so impactful, really.
Yeah.
So would you speak to that?
Why don't I answer that question before you go to your second question?
Okay.
You bring up the very contentious issue about voluntary stopping, which is related to dementia, but somewhat separate from it, in that it's voluntary sort of assumes that the person has some degree of sort of personal sort of ability to guide their care, and so it's tricky to talk about voluntary stopping of eating and drinking for dementia, because you're talking about somebody else making that decision rather than the person themselves. And so I would just say that it's tricky and it's hard, and tremendous work has been done by a guy in the audience right now, Dr. Stan Terman, who's back there. He has been thinking very long and hard about this very issue, and has developed very sort of advanced and good a good system for helping people navigate through that. But it's tricky.
What's his name and where is he?
He's back there, Dr. Stan Terman. Yep. Yeah. And so actually, before we get to your second question, why don't we take somebody else's question and circle back to you if we have time.
I just wanted to say that when you're faced with that, often the process is very fluid, so you may tell people that their opinion about what they want changes through the course.
Yeah.
And even delegating who's going to be your power of attorney for healthcare,
yeah.
that changed many times as we learned who actually picks up the phone when
right.
you call in an emergency.
Yeah.
And so cautioning people, choose someone who's going to pick up the phone.
And
have a good backup.
Yeah.
Hi. I have a question regarding advanced directive. And as you just mentioned, standard advanced directive and dementia advanced directive. And in San Francisco, the mental health system also has a psychiatric advanced directive. So my question is, right now seems to be have different advanced directive. Which one we should pick for the patient, because sometimes some elderly, they have dementia, also coexist psychiatric disorder.
Yeah, yeah. So that's a really good question. And the group in Seattle, Washington, End of Life Washington, has thought really hard about how does advanced directive for dementia relate to advanced directive for mental health. And so years ago, they developed a advanced directive for dementia at End of Life Washington that anybody can download for free. It's 30 pages long, and it's clearly written sort of by a lawyer, so it's very, very detailed and legal. And it's written in a very specific way to align itself with the mental health law for the state of Washington. So it's tricky, but it brings up the very important and good question that that many states do have advanced directive for mental health, which is can include dementia, but doesn't necessarily do so. In which there is a legal framework in many states that allows somebody ahead of time to identify a proxy who they would give consent to guide their care if they were in a mental health emergency such that they weren't able to make decisions for themselves. And it's a little bit odd because there are many situations in which people are in that state in which you don't necessarily need to have a document like that. But mental health is different, and that our society has moved so much into making sure that people who have mental illness have a lot of agency over their own care, that it's a gray area in many states. So there are very useful laws in many states that set up a mental health directive, which can and many people should take use of if they are thinking about the care that they would want if they developed dementia, because as we all know, many people with dementia do develop psychiatric conditions in which they might need to be hospitalized, but they might not give consent for that hospitalization, and there might be uncertainty on the part of an emergency room doctor as to, can I admit somebody involuntarily if they're telling me I don't want to go, but it really does seem like the best thing for their care.
Dr. Gaster, you have done a great job of bringing this issue to great public awareness, and that's terrific. Since the last time we met, I think it was in November of 2016. And you've really shied away from the controversial issues to make it more widely accepted and discussed. But sometimes you cannot, you can take the legal out of your advanced directive, but you can't keep them out.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the problem. With Margot Bentley, 5 years of forced feeding, according to her daughter and according to her husband, and she ended up looking like a Holocaust victim.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And because they put in, they went to court 3 times, and it was a horrific situation. And same thing with Nora Harris and many others. There is, in your last sentence of your intervention, in your directive the sentence, I would not want any care that would prolong my life. Any is a very broad term, and it could be included in terms of assistance with oral feeding.
Yeah.
Has anyone used it that way? And I really take the opposite. You know, my name is Stan Terman. I have my Caring Advocates is the website. So I think we should try to accept the reality that the attorneys, the do-gooders, are going to sometimes, with good intention, force people to be fed by spoon for many years. And a PBS winning award, award-winning film by Carol Roberts called Facing Alzheimer's, Facing the Facts, Alzheimer's Disease, has a nice little vignette. 15 years, the husband has been dutifully feeding his wife, and she hasn't said a word to him.
Yeah, and so let me just say that I absolutely agree with you that for people who want their directive to be, you know, as you eloquently put it, ironclad, if you want your directive to be able to withstand, you know, the unusual but very possible legal challenges that could come up, that you do want to have it witnessed, you do want to have it notarized, you do want to consider a directive that specifically addresses manual assistance with eating and drinking. But, you know, like I also said before, in doing so, the directive becomes more complex, it becomes more controversial, and from the point of view of a primary care doctor who, you know, takes care of a couple of thousand people, you know, through all walks of life, some of whom are very concerned about this, some of whom are less so. For me, the benefit, the most immediate goal is to get more people to say that if their wishes are that if in advanced dementia they would want comfort-oriented care only, that making that easy and clear for them to fill out is the greatest benefit, and that the more sort of legal sort of safeguard you put in it, the more complex it is and the more it scares people away, and the less people are going to fill it out. And so, it's definitely, I absolutely appreciate your perspective, and you are right. You are right that there are horrible, you know, very, very sort of well documented situations where things have become very legal and horrible and contentious. And if you want your directive to be protected against those situations, then you need more than my form, absolutely. But I would just say that the delegalization of these forms and making it more of a conversation is important and is useful, and so I would just encourage people to talk about it and think about it in that way.
Thank you very much. You've done some amazing work, and as a palliative care nurse, I appreciate getting that conversation going. How does this work together with a pulsed form?
Yeah, so that's another really, really good, important question that I get asked a lot. So a pulsed form is very different than an advanced directive, which is confusing, though, because in some ways you are saying your wishes in advance, but the common way that most advanced directives are written, including my form, it is all about if I'm in a future state, which I'm not in right now, this is what my wishes would be for the goals of medical care that I had. Whereas a pulsed form is these are my wishes and goals of care for right now. And so a pulsed form says that right now, if medics came out to my house, I would not want to be resuscitated if I had cardiac arrest. So the pulse form is for, you know, it's physician orders, PO is physician orders for care given right now, as opposed to the more standard way that we think of advanced directives being in the future, if I'm in a persistent vegetative state, if I develop dementia, in those future states of myself, this is what I would want my goals of care to be. And so I think of a pulse form as an incredibly important document that a family helps to fill out in the moderate to severe stages of dementia, but it's filled out at the point where you're at that stage of dementia, as opposed to something that you could do before you developed dementia.
Excuse me, I have a question. I'm over here. You said two things. Okay. Here.
Oh, got it. Thank you.
You said two. Actually, you said something that I think is really interesting. You said the pulse form could be created by the family. And that's, I think there's some controversy over that too. If the person does not have a durable power of attorney for healthcare and they have not designated someone to speak for them, then there is nobody to make the pulse form. And so my question really is there anything that can be done for people who did not create a durable, who did not delegate somebody, whether it's your form or it's the legal form, the durable power of attorney form, for someone after they have more than mild cognitive deficits?
Yeah. So, I mean, the vast majority of people in America have not filled out a durable power of attorney form. And so it's an incredibly common scenario that somebody is not able to make medical decisions for themselves, and there is not a durable power of attorney form. And so pretty much every state has legal wording for what happens in such a situation. And you know, just about every state will set up a hierarchy of who the relationship to you would be as that sort of surrogate decision maker, you know, with mostly the spouse being sort of number one. And so it's absolutely true that it can be heart-wrenching and difficult if there isn't a durable power of attorney form filled out. But most of the time, I think a lawyer would say that there is statute for each individual state that identifies who the surrogate decision maker would be in that setting. All right, thank you all very much. And again, we'll be up here with some time as a panel to answer your questions as a group. So thank you all very much.